This is a politic-free zone. That's how we usually refer to it a little bit. But, man, it is not a politic-free time right now. So that creates a feeling that things are being silenced, and I don't like that feeling because this is a place where you can bring your whole life. And I would hope that our faith actually informs how we feel about various issues going on in the world. If there's a disconnect there, then something's gone wrong. The reason that we have basically said don't talk about politics in church is because it's such a weird thing when we start to define ourselves by our politics. And we just sat here and sang, beautifully led, might I add, about a God who loves us deeply and how we're united in the fact that we are loved and forgiven people. And sometimes that unity gets lost a little bit. This week in our, well, actually 2 weeks ago, in our small group, we've been studying James, and we're reading about taming the tongue, which is fairly impossible to do, and about all kinds of devastation that can come from how we speak. But our words have weight. I mean, Jesus said, out of the overflow of our hearts, the mouth speaks. And there's weight there. I've felt that weight this weekend from somebody that I would call a dear friend, and it wasn't pleasant. But it says, with the tongue we praise our Lord and Father, just like we did. But with it we also curse men who've been made in God's likeness. And out of the same mouth comes praise and cursing. My brothers, that shouldn't be. I don't think that's mostly talking about using swear words. It's actually talking about how we speak to other people. So all that to say, as you move through this very potent political time, may the tenor of our speech reflect the love of our Lord, and may it be something that does build people up rather than tear people down. May it be something that expresses what is right and good in the world, and not something that destroys what is right and good in the world. I was thrilled, frankly. I know I'm not supposed to talk politics, take sides or anything, but I'm thrilled to see congregation members who took the time yesterday to go and walk to empower people and to stand against injustice and to stand for equality. Those are all incredibly good things. I would be less excited to see congregation members who spend their time out there to tear a group of people down because of what they think or believe. So, enough of that. I felt like I had to say it, but it is where we're at. We're in the middle of a series, and we're talking about how God shapes our lives through crucial moments. And those moments seem to come on a regular basis. And oftentimes we don't even know which moments are the crucial ones, but we can see the dominoes blow out of them as to what it affects our lives. And I looked up the definition of crucial, and it's that which sets us up for success or failure. Now, how you define that is a weird thing, but I think we all want to be better people, and we all want to have what the Lord has for us in our lives, and God is the author of all good things, and so that's where we're headed. How we partner with God through these moments that come up in our lives is how he shapes our lives. So that's what we're exploring, how God shapes our lives. And over the next 2 weeks, we're going to look into how God shapes our lives through scarcity and prosperity. Now, my guess is we can relate with at least one or the other of those, if not both of those, at any given moment, because scarcity is not just a financial state. You can have scarcity in all sorts of areas. I'm going to have to pay for this later, but my wife just went on a trip to California. I didn't bring this up. It just came to me. I have to share. But family can be a challenging place to go and to interact with, and there is a scarcity, and we prayed for God to meet her in the midst of it, and I think God did just that. So can you think of, in your life, either a time or an area where you feel a scarcity? It can be all sorts of things. It can be emotional scarcity. It can be scarcity to do what you feel like you're supposed to be doing, to face an opportunity, or to interact with somebody in a way that you know you could do better. I think we can all relate with some level of scarcity. A friend of mine, he's a great guy, he's a good friend, And he went to Haiti to start an orphanage when he found out about all these kids that were living just out on the streets because their parents were gone or had died. And so he felt like, man, me and my wife, we need to go down there and create an orphanage. And this stuff kind of was coming together for it. And so he scraped together every bit of money that he could to go do this. And didn't have enough. So he called his family and said, are you willing to help me with this? And they said, sure, we can help you. But he still didn't have enough. And I remember him being so frustrated because it felt like, man, this thing that I need to go do, I can't do. And that's the feeling of scarcity. He wasn't able to do it in and of himself. And then he ended up going around to a bunch of different churches and sharing with them this idea that he wanted to go do. And a number of them came alongside. And I remember him telling me afterwards, I'm so glad I didn't have enough. Because now I have partners. And now I have other people who are in this with me. And I got to see how God could provide for the stuff that he wants to do. And I think that is, that story captures for me both the challenge and the blessing of scarcity. We live in a country where we do not like the idea of scarcity. The American dream is built on the idea that somehow if I can accumulate enough stuff, I can make a situation where I will never have to face scarcity again. And in the midst of doing that, we lose all sorts of things. Two big ones, dependency on God and dependency on other people. We somehow believe that we are self-sufficient when we don't have scarcity. So there are blessings to be had in it, but I want to be the type of person who gets those blessings. I don't want to have to go through scarcity just to go through it for the fun of going through it, because it's actually not fun. It's stressful and painful. And so how do we be people who access the good stuff that God has for us in scarcity? Let me tell you another quick story. My own coming of faith story. I had tried to do life kind of the way I thought I should do it. My parents didn't give me a lot of guidance when it came to like religious stuff. My experience in my dad's church was not all that great. I don't ever remember hearing about Jesus, which is weird for a church. And I got through confirmation class and still hadn't heard about Jesus. And then they said, at this point, you can decide whether you want to go to church anymore. And I said, sweet, I'm out of here. And then when I was living with my mom, which was every other year, she would say, I'll take you to anything that you want to go to that's religious in nature. You just got to tell me what it is. And it was sort of a potpourri of Seattle, and I didn't even know where to begin with that. And so it was enough for me to decide whether to be in Boy Scouts or not. So that was that. So I tried to do life as best as I could, and it was an incredibly challenging spot to come to the realization that I wasn't figuring it out and that life wasn't turning out the way I wanted it to turn out. I was going down this downward spiral, and everything I tried seemed to not be working. I felt a scarcity. I didn't know how to make life work. And so it was a very humbling thing to call a friend of mine and to say, I need your help. Can you help me with this? And she invited me to church. And I went to church, and it was a humbling thing to then come to a place where I said, man, I need Jesus' help. And that's kind of the start of the point of the gospel. You can fix it. Wow. All right. We've been distracted by technology. It's not the first time. I reached this point where I had to say I needed God. The Ten Commandments, they're great, great guidance on how to live life. And yet when Jesus reinterprets them, he says, it says, thou shalt not kill. But if you've hated a person in your heart, then you've committed murder in your heart. And his point in saying that is not to say, man, you're all murderers, you're rotten. His point is to say, you're not measuring up. And that brings us to a spot where we go, man, I need something to help fill in the gap. Scarcity is about a gap. So how are we going to face scarcity? If you're going to be a person who addresses scarcity well, it's good to look at stories where scarcity happens in the scriptures. And we're going to look at John chapter 6, the feeding of the 5,000. Talking about scarcity, not enough lunch, 5,000 mouths to feed, that is some scarcity. So let me read John 6 for you, 1 through 15. It says this: "Sometime after this, Jesus crossed to the far shore of the Sea of Galilee, that is the Sea of Tiberias. And a great crowd of people had followed him because they saw the signs he had performed by healing the sick. And then Jesus went up on a mountainside and he sat down with his disciples. The Jewish Passover festival was near. And when Jesus looked up, he saw a great crowd coming towards him, and he said to Philip, 'Where shall we buy bread for these people to eat?' And he asked this only to test him, because he already knew in his mind what he was going to do. And Philip answered him, 'It would take more than a half a year's wages to buy enough bread for everybody to even have one bite.' And another of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up, 'Well, here's a boy with 5 small barley loaves and 2 small fish, but how far can that go among so many?' And Jesus said, 'Well, have the people sit down. There's plenty of grass in this place.' And they sat down. There's about 5,000 men were there. It's not including women and children. Jesus then took the loaves, gave thanks, and distributed to those who were seated as much as they wanted. And he did the same with the fish. When they'd all had enough to eat, he said to his disciples, 'Gather the pieces that are left over. Let nothing be wasted.' And so they gathered them, filled 12 baskets with the pieces of the 5 barley loaves left over by those who had eaten." Let's pray. God, we don't like facing scarcity. We desperately try to avoid it. And yet, in the midst of scarcity, you do amazing things. And so, God, teach us to be people who face scarcity well. Be people who receive what you have for us. Guide us, direct us as we consider this story from your life. We love you. Amen. I love how Jesus approaches scarcity with his disciples in this text. He approaches it with a question: where are we going to get bread to feed these people? It sort of like opens up a dialogue. He says it just to test them. But I think it's almost like he says it with like a twinkle in his eye. Like, "Hey, where shall we get bread for these people? You want to go down to the market?" And I love how Jesus does that, because it opens things up. When I face scarcity, I usually shut things down. I don't know if that's how you experience it. But I know for me, my first response to scarcity is panic. What am I going to do? I don't have a clue what I'm going to do. And then my next move is to find the most plausible solution that I can have to fix this, that probably the first one that comes to my mind, because I feel like time is of the essence and I need to act quickly if I'm going to get over this moment of very uncomfortable scarcity. And so I look for any solution, then I start to try to execute it as quickly as possible. Panic and then act, and usually not the right way. That has not served me very well in the past. I just want you to know that is not a good model for how to tackle scarcity. So it's good to sit and learn from Jesus on this one. And I kind of wish the disciples had done the same thing. Instead of like coming up with their answer of, "Well, gosh, Jesus, you're asking for something ridiculous," what if they had said, "I don't know, Lord, what shall we do?" It would have been an interesting conversation, but we don't get it because they jumped to go to act. So what if instead we approach it with Jesus and like Jesus as an opportunity to see what God can do? Here we are. Things are scarce. I wonder how God will show up in this. Because there is a recognition for Jesus that, one, God is in control, and that God is sufficient. Those two things are something that I don't see Jesus miss very often. God is in control, and he knows he can handle it. Easier said than done, right? So I just gave you the advice that when you face scarcity, just remember, God's in control. He's sufficient. You got this. That is much easier said than done. Philip's answer is probably much more practical to how we answer. Jesus, you are crazy. Would you be reasonable? That's half a year's wages just to give everybody a bite. This is ridiculous. In other words, he recognizes he has something, but it is not near enough. And sometimes the gap between what we need and what we have feels very large. And in a way, that is a blessing as well. Here's the reason why. Because it's when that gap is a little bit wider that we all of a sudden fall to our knees and realize, I can't do this alone. I have told you often about my sermon preparation process. Here's how it generally goes. I sit down, I study the passage, and then I start to write. And then it doesn't work. Because I feel like I'm somewhat capable of doing this. And then I do this for long enough that I realize this is not working. And then I go, God, I really need your help. I have no clue what I'm going to have to say on Sunday, but I'm still going to have to get up there. Save me. And then it begins to come together. When the gap feels wide enough between our scarcity and what we can actually accomplish and what we need, then it's big enough for us to call on the Lord. There's a downside to the gap, though. When it feels like something is so big we can't actually fix it, there's a tendency to not do anything, to give up. Hopelessness, disengagement. I've come up with a term for it. I don't know if it's out there. It may already be out there, but paralysis of magnitude. I feel paralysis of magnitude sometimes, especially when I look around at big problems in the world. Lack of food to feed people, even in our own city. I don't know how to fix that. So I think I'll go watch DVD. We throw up our hands and we give up. Man, I can't do this. And that's what I feel like the disciples are doing here. Saying, I can't do this, Lord. It's too big. Injustices in the world, racism, I don't know how to fix it, and so it's tempting to just do nothing, so we escape. I have felt this way about politics. I know what I'm not going to talk about politics. I just want to disengage from it, because I don't know how to do anything that's actually going to produce anything good in the midst of it. So I just try to disengage from it. My friend Carmen, on the other hand, she's an engager. She's like a system changer. She's this Presbyterian pastor in Charleston. And she wanted to do something about who was getting appointed for something. And she said, does anybody know the number I can call? And so I followed her story about what was going on with that. And she spoke up and she said, I just got off the phone. We had a great conversation. And the interesting thing was, it wasn't about what she accomplished. She said, I now have a better understanding of what's going on. And I feel heard. She took a step towards something and gained something from it. And as I was thinking about that, I remember my own time of going downtown every weekend to talk to guys who were homeless. There's two sorts of volunteers that would show up at the soup kitchen that I would go to. And at the soup kitchen, there's the volunteers who they like serve the food and everything, and then they get a table all together by themselves and they talk about how cool it is that they were able to come here and serve some food. And I think that's great. They were helping feed somebody who needed a meal, and they're getting a chance to like revel in the fact that they helped somebody. That's fantastic. But then there were these other volunteers who would come and they would serve food, and then they would go sit with these guys. And luckily I had a mentor at the time who said, you should go sit with them. So I'd sit with them and we'd talk, and I'd get to hear their stories about how they got there. And the thing that surprised me the most was that I began to understand that the problem wasn't just resources. But the other thing was, I met some phenomenal people. I met a guy who was homeless, and he spent every day getting warm by going to the library and reading about a subject that he was interested in that day. He was like a Renaissance man. You could talk to him about anything. And he knew a lot about everything. One of the smartest cats I've ever met, honestly. But I was walking away going, wow, how cool is it that I got to meet this guy? As you engage, you get something from it. So giving up and throwing up our hands, we don't get anything from the experience of scarcity. It's just moving through it because you have to move through it. And God has something better. Another thing that comes along with getting stuck and unable to do anything is a sense that somebody else needs to take care of this. And Matthew sets up the same story a slightly different way. He says, as evening approached, the disciples came to him and said, Jesus, we're in a remote place. It's getting late. Please send the crowds away so they can go to the village and buy themselves some food. So they're in the midst of a really cool ministry time. Jesus is healing people. John had mentioned that. He's teaching people about the kingdom of God. They're getting it. They're connecting with the Lord. Good things are happening, but they go to him and go, Jesus, enough. It's quitting time. There's nothing more that can be done. We've run out of resources. We ran out of food. So therefore, the stuff that God wants to do needs to grind to a halt. Which is kind of funny when you think about it. God can't manage the food service problem, so we need to flip that off. And there's this sense with Jesus that, well, we can keep doing it. There's a switch that gets flipped when we start to realize that God is sufficient and that God is possible, so we're going to keep moving forward. As I got to sit down and talk about where's Harbor Church going to move with the pastor of Luther Memorial, she's a phenomenal lady, but as we sat there and talked, I said, you know, I don't know if this is going to work because our service time, I don't see how we can move it to an early enough time that you guys can keep your service time, and at some point we're not going to have separate spaces because the place where we're going to initially start meeting is going to get torn out. Maybe this is not going to work. And she responded to me by going, do you think it's what God wants to do? Is to bring us into partnership? And I said, yeah. She goes, well, then we'll find a way. And we started to creatively talk about what if Congregation 1 meets at this time, Congregation 2 meets at that time. And at this point, they are talking about how they're ready to move their service back a half an hour. They've been there forever meeting at the same time. They're going to move their service time because this is what God wants to do. There's a sense of possibility when we begin to realize that God can meet us in our scarcity. Many of you know that I started a church in my house. God bless Christina for putting up with that for a long time. And we kind of had 3 years of a good run, and I poured a lot into it and dreamt about it. And Christina was worried that when we closed the church, that was going to be the end of me as a pastor. Like it was going to crush me to crush this thing that we had started together. And it didn't become a self-sustaining thing that was moving forward. And I began to chalk it up to not having the right kind of resources. Well, we don't have that like dynamic person who brings guests all the time. And I don't know how to create that. And if only someone had come up here, or if only we didn't have our church down the street from a mega church at the time that seemed to suck everybody into being interested in it. If only we had a better space. And there was the sense that there was nothing I could do about it. It was a learned helplessness almost that began to develop in me. And we were talking about this at our Wednesday morning Bible study. They've done lots of experiments that prove that we can learn to be completely helpless. If you go to the zoo, you can see like giant apes and stuff sitting in a cage. But I'm betting when they first got in that cage, they rattled the bars and stuff. They were like, let me out. I got to get back to wherever I was going. But after a while, you go like visit them and you like look at them and they're just like, you can wave at them and they just kind of sit there. And something happened where they go, I'm done. Scarcity can create that sense of done. But if we go down that road, we will not gain anything. Doors close down. It is what it is. We give up. And so Jesus, when the disciples start down this road of going, just send them away, we can't do anything, it's over, He nudges them back on track with verse 16 of Matthew 14, where he says, you know what, guys? Give them something to eat. Now, this is where I want to pause, because this isn't how the story goes, but what if the disciples had taken their own loaves and fishes at that point and said, Jesus said to do it. Okay, here's some bread and fish that I have. Here's some bread and fish that I have. Okay, Jesus, I gave him something to eat. My guess is the story would have gone totally differently, because they would have kept giving away the loaves and the fishes that they had until everybody had had enough to eat, and then they would look around and go, wait a minute. That was only 12 lunches that Jesus just did that with. That's kind of cool. But instead, they don't. Because they wouldn't take the step. So how do we not freeze up and get paralyzed by the magnitude of scarcity? How do we not get helpless? How do we not panic? And I love the gospel because it's a little boy who shows us the way. A little boy with 5 loaves and 2 fishes, John 6, verse 8. Another of the disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up. Well, here's a boy with 5 small barley loaves. And 2 small fish. But how far can that go among so many people? Here's what I love about this boy's response. 1, he doesn't worry about how big the problem is. He says, here's what I got. It's all that I got, but it's here's what I got. Do you want it? So imagine he's sitting there in this crowd. He hears the disciples and Jesus starting to squabble over the fact that everybody's hungry. We should probably put an end to this thing. And he goes, oh, people are hungry? I have lunch. Here's what I got. I'll give it to Jesus. Now, the cool thing about that is instead of being caught up in the impossibilities of it all, he says, I can be helpful. It creates an adventure when we step out with what we have and see what God can do. Because we don't know how it's going to end. But it's bound to be interesting. The other thing that I love about him is, what does that say about that little boy's heart? Oh yeah, I am hungry. I should probably eat this before anybody else gets hungry and takes it from me. That could have been a good little kid response. But no, he says, I want my heart to be available. I want myself to be available to those around me. And as he does this again and again, his parents begin to say things about him like, man, he's just such a nice, generous kid. He likes to give. It'll probably get him into trouble at some point, but look at his heart. His heart gets softer. Andrew and Philip's heart gets harder when they say, we can't do this. Send them away. Jesus, what you're asking for is impossible. I can't step into that. The key to facing scarcity, the more and more think about it and pray about it, is this: do the little thing that's not enough right again and again and again. I am taking up a new hobby. I like weird, quirky hobbies, by the way, because I'm a weird, quirky guy. So I have taken up curling. Do you know what curling is? Yes. I go on a sheet of ice and I push a big 40-pound stone down that ice and try to get it to stop on a bullseye. That's in essence what curling is. And as I've begun to delve into this little interesting hobby, the people who are helping me along the way go, figure out how to do it right and then do it again and again and again and again until you can do it when you want to be able to do it. Do the right thing again and again. Repeat. And the funny thing is, we know that this works in every other area of the world. Like, that's how God made things. If I want to be able to do a pull-up, I go to the gym and I start to do progress. By the way, I was talking to a friend of mine about this recently, and she said, you know, I couldn't do a pull-up at first, so I just started above the bar and then I let myself down. And then I did that again and again, and eventually I was able to start pulling myself up, but it took again and again and again and again. If you want to save money, they say it's not about saving a huge amount, right? It's not about taking like half your paycheck and dumping it into savings when you can, and then that's good. That's how you train yourself to be a saver. No, it's taking a little bit, but doing it every time, and again and again and again and again and again. Anytime you've learned something, that's how you've done it. So why wouldn't it work with other things, like the stuff that God wants to do? Like forgiving people. I told you that I had a stepmom that I didn't like before. At a crucial time in my life, I was like 13, 12, something like that, my dad married a woman I did not get along with at all. And she quickly was in charge of my life. This was a very, I think, repeatable story of a kid who hates his stepmom, basically. And it was the story of the redheaded stepchild. That would be me. I hated this lady. Fast forward, get into Bible school, right? And I end up with a roommate who has a gift for counseling, of all things. Really? And so I was talking to him and telling him about my parents. And I was like, yeah, I got this one hard spot in my life, though. I cannot forgive this lady. And he said, well, can you say that God loves her? I'm like, maybe. And I eventually brought myself to a point where I could say, you know what? God loves her and I have no clue why. And that began to transform into, God loves her, I guess, to, God loves her and forgives her, to, God loves her and maybe I can forgive her, to, God forgives her and I guess I forgive her, to, well, she was there for my dad in ways that he needed her to be, too. She's a pretty cool lady. I don't want to spend time with her. I think that's about where we are now. We'll see if it goes any further. But there's a progression there of doing the thing that God wants again and again until you get there. That's how we tackle scarcity. Jesus, in the parable of the talent, talks about he's leaving town and there's a master of a house, and he gives one coin to one guy and five coins to another and 10 coins to another. And the guy who gets 10 coins goes out and puts it to work and earns some interest and has 20 coins by the time the master comes back. And the guy who got 5 coins, he also puts it to work and gets another 5 coins by the time the master's back. And the guy who gets 1 coin buries it. He's scared that he's going to lose it. So he digs it up when the master comes back. And he doesn't have anything to show for the time. And in that parable, the guy who had 10, he gets 10 more. The master goes, you know what? Give him even more. I can tell he's going to do something good with it. And the guy who has 5, he goes, give him some more as well. Because I know he's going to do something with it. And then the guy who gets 1, he says, you know what? Take away that 1 from him. Because you know what? He's not going to do anything with it, even if we give him more stuff. There is this principle in working with God and partnering with him that if we give God what we have, even if it's not enough, he can use it to do more. In this story we're looking at, Jesus says, you know what? Have the people sit down. There's plenty of grass in this place. And 5,000 men plus women and children, what, 10, 12,000 people. Jesus then took the loaves, gave thanks, and distributed to those who were seated as much as they wanted. And he did the same with the fish. And then he told the disciples to gather all the pieces. Don't let anything get wasted. And they gathered 12 baskets full. Jesus, in other words, says, I will take what you have. I will add what I have. And that will be enough. That's how God works. But it's a partnership. God does the heavy lifting. But if we don't do anything, the story doesn't work. Larry is the king of reminding me, God's been faithful to you so far. Think he'll do it again? Like, you're all here. You have been through some stuff. We've all been through some stuff. And yet, God brought you through it. So, won't he do it again? You'll probably get through this, too. The crazy thing that blows my mind about this story is every one of the disciples probably had what that boy had. A couple loaves, a couple of fishes. The boy was the only one who stepped up and did something with it. And so he got to see his stuff in God's hands. One last little thing. How many baskets were left?
12.
How many disciples were there?
12.
So, as the guys are leaving this incredible event, they're all carrying a basket of bread. They get to carry it for a while. I don't know how long Jesus had them carry that. Probably long enough that they would remember the story later when it was time to write it down. But that memory, that holding on to how God has been faithful when you had little, he had much, and you two worked together, sticks with them and carries them to the next time. And if you're actually reading the feeding of the 5,000, you'll find shortly thereafter the feeding of the 4,000. Probably made it possible because they remembered, oh yeah, Jesus did this last time. Maybe it'll work again. Who knows? So practically, how do you face scarcity? Lean into it. Give God a chance to work. You probably don't have enough, but lean into it. Let God do something. Two, take a step in the right direction, and then take another step, and then take another step, and see how far you can go. And three, God's grace is sufficient. I want to read 2 Corinthians 9:8 for you. It says this, each man should give what he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, because God loves a cheerful giver. Heard that passage before. But then it says this, and God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that in all things, at all times, having what you need, you'll be able to abound in every good work. In other words, if God has something for you, he's going to provide for you to do it. His grace is sufficient. If you are in a time of scarcity, whether it's emotional, whether it's spiritual, whether it is financial, God is there with you. And he never shows up on our timeline. That's the part of it that bugs me, right? Okay, God, provide now so that I don't have to stress. That's not how it works. Because it's when we start to go, I don't have enough. I'll give you what I got. Then the rest comes together. It was as the disciples started handing out food that the people got fed. Allow God to work with you in your story, to meet you in the midst of the scarcity as you walk through it with him, and you will see the abundance and the provision of God. And remember, scarcity takes a lot of forms. And if you're not in a position of scarcity, look for the scarce among you. You got them. Maybe it's somebody who needs your friendship. That can mean a lot to someone. I know, because I have been recently trying to schedule things around the church. We need all the talented, gifted, not so talented, I can even do something ordinary people to make this thing work together. There's a reason that Dave and Richard are playing music every week, because we need them too. Like, there's, when you give your gifts, things come together. People need your presence and your character and your love this week. So, we may not be much. We might only have a few loaves, a few fishes that we can give to other people. But let's do it. Let's be the hands and feet of God this week. Let's let God meet us in the midst of our scarcity. And let's be God's provision to those who are feeling scarce. Sound good? All right, let's pray. God, thanks for being good. Thanks for doing more than we can ever hope or imagine with what little we bring to the table. God, it's easy to talk about stuff like this. It's not so easy not to panic and not to stress. And so God, lead us in the midst. Surround us with people. But more than ever, Lord, help us to rely on you and help us to take the right step in the right direction and see what you can do instead of just giving up. God, thanks for your grace, your love, your provision, for everything that we could hope for. So God, do what you're going to do with us this week. We love you. Amen.